I'm Jessica Lee. I'm a scientist at NASA's Ames Research Center in Silicon Valley, and I study microbes in space. And when I tell people that, a common question that I get is, do you think there's microbial life out there? And as a space biologist, I feel obliged to say, I know there's microbial life out there because we brought it with us. So this is one of the things that separates me from exobiologists and astrobiologists. As a space biologist, I study what happens to life from Earth when we send it to space. And contrary to what you might be led to believe by our cute mission patches, microbes that go to space are not given spacesuits. So what they experience when they go to space actually differs quite a lot from what humans experience when they go to space. Part of that is due to the fact that there are a lot of different ways for microbes to get to space. So I'll go over a few of those right now. As I'm sure you all know, where there are humans, there are microbes. And one place that humans have been in space for over 2 decades now is the International Space Station, or the ISS. And people there, they work, they exercise, they eat, and they distribute their microbes around the environment. So we find them and we monitor microbes. But there are also microbes that get to the International Space Station because we bring them on purpose to be model organisms in experiments. And so you'll find those enclosed in space biology hardware like this or like this. And then there are microbes that hitch a ride to space on uncrewed spacecraft, so ones with no people, because despite our best efforts, no spacecraft ever really leaves Earth 100% sterile. But then there are also cases where we haven't even tried that hard. So the Apollo missions all left bags of garbage behind on the lunar surface, and a lot of those bags had solid human waste in them, including all the microbes that come with that. So what happens to these microbes that are in space? What do they do? What do they feel? Again, that depends on how they got there. So let's go through a couple of examples. For instance, on one end of the spectrum, say that you are a microbe that hitchhikes on a lunar rover. When you get to the surface of the moon and you're deployed there, you get to experience the raw environment of space in all of its stresses. So that includes UV radiation, temperature extremes on the lunar surface between 50 and 400 degrees Kelvin, solar particle radiation, and space vacuum. So if you're a typical mesophilic vegetative cell, you're probably toast right away. If you're a spore, on the other hand, you have a slightly better chance of surviving. Of course, if you land near the equator of the moon, unfortunately, you still will probably get killed within one lunar cycle by either the UV, or if not the UV, then the vacuum or the heat extremes or some combination of those. But if you're lucky enough to have landed near the pole where solar radiation is less extreme, the temperatures are less extreme, or if you're really lucky and you are on the inside of the spacecraft, then you actually could hold out for a little while. And there was a model published in 2019, in fact, that estimated that of the spacecraft that were on the lunar surface at that time, probably a handful of them still had viable microbes from space. Why do you think that we would even bother with such calculations, right? Besides the fact that they're inherently, I think, really cool to think about. So one of the main reasons there is planetary protection, right? So calculating microbial survival in space helps us implement practices that then in turn can help us prevent ourselves from spreading earthly microbes as contamination to other planets. Okay, on the other end of the extreme, say that you're a microbe that was brought to space on purpose to be part of an experiment. In that case, you'll be shielded from most of the lethal effects that we were just talking about. So then what do you have to worry about? Well, there are still risks to spaceflight in a human habitable environment. NASA has identified those for astronauts, so we could refer to the hazards that they've identified for astronauts, and there are 5 of them. I think only 2 of them are really applicable across all organisms, and so we'll focus on those, space radiation and gravity. And we'll talk about the more complex one first. So as far as we know, bacterial cells don't have a mechanism for sensing the force of gravity directly. And yet, we have seen Multiple experiments show evidence of altered phenotypes from microbes in space, including changes in growth rate, changes in virulence. So what is it that microbes are reacting to, if not to gravity? One of our best ideas in this area is that it has to do with the physical environment of the liquid that they're in. Okay, so if you're a microbe in liquid culture on Earth, so say down here, you're probably going to be exchanging chemicals with your environment and thereby possibly changing the net density of the fluid that's immediately around you. You may see heterogeneity in pockets of density in that fluid. And so if you're on Earth, gravity is going to pull the denser pockets of fluid down. The less dense pockets of fluid will go up, and you'll get circulation, so density-driven convection, as shown by the arrows in this diagram. When you're in space, there's nothing to pull the denser fluid down, so that doesn't move. The less dense fluid doesn't move, and nothing moves, really. So then you're in an environment where mixing is pretty slow. It's driven by diffusion primarily, and you can get some funny concentration gradients that that can really stress cells out. In addition, you'll be missing some of the hydrodynamic shear forces that cells might otherwise be feeling on the surface of their cell if the fluid were moving. You could say, why not just stir your bioreactor if all you need in microgravity is to move it? Well, of course that would be a solution, but in truth, a lot of the bioreactors on space station look like this. It is way easier to just use a bag than to have moving parts. And so we're still concerned with what is going on in these stationary fluid bioreactors. On Earth, we can simulate some of these effects by using rotational wall vessels, which you may have heard of if you've attended any of the other space biology talks at this meeting. And my group is using computational modeling to look at the interactions among the physical, chemical, and biological components of the system. Okay, space radiation is our last one. We talked earlier about how lethal UV radiation is to microbes that are on the exterior of a spacecraft. But if you're on the interior of a spacecraft, especially one that's in deep space, so near the moon or Mars, then the flavor of radiation you're going to care most about is the kind of radiation that's very hard to shield from. So that is high energy particle radiation. Here's a model to help you visualize that. So say you have cells, which are shown here as blue circles, and they are essentially traversed by a handful of protons, which are a component of galactic cosmic radiation, or GCR. Those are shown as green tracks. So when a charged particle zips through the medium, it'll deposit some energy in all of the matter that it interacts with, which can cause some direct damage to cell components like DNA. The charged particle will also react with the water in the medium to generate reactive oxygen species, and these cause oxidative stress, which is another major component of what we think is going on here. But as you notice, it's sort of a spatially heterogeneous kind of stress, right? Some cells get hit very badly. Other cells are completely unscathed. So for multicellular organisms like humans, we have sort of a pretty good idea of what to expect from deep space radiation in terms of health effects. But for microbial systems, we actually have very little information about what to expect for the population level, and especially how that might be changed by changes in the physical conformations of the cells. So my group is studying this through computational models like this one, also through radiation experiments on the ground. Although I should say, if you want to study galactic cosmic rays on Earth, you have to go to a particle accelerator like NASA Space Radiation Lab, which is shown here. And those are our cells and spin pods waiting to be radiated. So there are numerous good reasons to study microbes in an inhabited space environment. My favorite one is the fact that we are going to need microbes to help sustain human life when we go to deep space. So we're going to need these microbes to do work for us, like producing oxygen or producing microbial foods or maybe helping our plants grow. So I hope that maybe I've given you a little bit of inspiration to start thinking about how you as a microbiologist, how your work might interact with some of these challenges. And overall, I hope that I've convinced you that sometimes it's useful to think about spaceflight from the perspective of a microbial cell. Thanks very much.